Hey, it's Tom from Texas, and it's time for another Floppy Deep Dive. And today, I am going to go over a retro buying guide and all the little things that I have learned since I got back into retro computers again. And just want to make it a one-stop video that people can go to and get the answers they need for like the top questions that everybody asks when they get back into the Commodore 64. So today, we're going to go over the top 10 questions asked when getting back into retro gaming on the Commodore 64 128. Today we're going to answer the questions: can I use my old Commodore 64 power supply? Where can I get a Commodore 64 or 128? How should I buy retro computers online? Where can I get more information or ask questions about the Commodore 64 in 2021? How do I hook up my Commodore 64 128 to a monitor or TV in 2021? How can I save my floppies on my PC? What can I use to emulate Commodore 64 games on my PC? Where can I find games online? How can I emulate a 1541 if I don't own one? Who can repair my Commodore 64 128 if it's broken? These are the questions and the purpose of this video today.
So I hope you enjoy this video. Let's just get started rolling into it. I got my old power supply, and I've got quite a few of these now, basically bricks, that I don't use, but everybody warned me, do not use them. Quickest way to fry a chip. Now, of course, I used it all through the 80s, part of the 90s, and I never had any problems, but I'm not gonna doubt it. I truly believe there's people out there who have had problems and that these old Commodore 64 power supplies do truly potentially fry chips. So I'm going to give you a couple of options and what you can do to replace this so you can keep your retro Commodore 64 safe and not have any issues and frying any chips. So what are your options? You got a couple of them that I actually have tried personally myself. The first one and my most favorite is this new brick. It actually looks really cool, color, same color as the Commodore 64. And it's really good quality, works well. I have three of them. I have quite a few systems, so I had to change out all the power supplies. So Kevin Autumn is the gentleman who makes these. I don't know him personally. I have ordered his products. I highly recommend looking him up in the Commodore 64 groups. Where you can find him. Again, its name is Kevin Autumn, and I will put his name and put a picture up here for y'all guys. But this is just a really good way to make sure you're protecting your Commodore 64, and it's a great power supply. Now, I do have a second option for you, and this one came from overseas. I believe it came from Poland. Poland seems to be the place where you can get power supplies for your Commodore 64 and do it on eBay. This one's actually pretty cool. I've had no problems with this one so far. Lights up here and says C64, so it's really a nice little power supply, pretty light. So I would recommend this one too. So again, number one is my new brick. Number two is this nice little power supply from overseas, from Poland. Highly recommend them. Protect your Commodore 64. That way you don't get any fried chips. So if you don't currently own a Commodore 64 or a Commodore 128, and you're looking to purchase one, where do you get it? Well, there's a few places out there, but the main ones that I look at is I look at, like to buy local. So I look at Craigslist. Another one that I look at for local buys is the Facebook Marketplace. So you can purchase again local if something's close to you. And the reason I like local is because you cut out the shipping. A lot of things get broke when it's being shipped. And so it's just a better way to protect it, and you could check it out before you get it. The last place, of course, there's eBay. And eBay, of course, most of the time this would be shipping directly to you. So that would be another great source. One thing to look when you're looking at these ads for Commodore 64s and 128, it will mention that it is either not tested or untested. those, basically what that means is it broke. So if you're looking for a broke Commodore 64, great, you know, something to fix, something to work on if that's what you do. But if you're wanting to get right into it and play games and do relive the memories of the 80s on a working Commodore 64 128, then you want to look for one that says tested, because tested means they've tried it out. Like I said, another reason I enjoyed the local is because you get a chance, you can test it out, it's nice and close, to see if it's working or not. So those are the options that I use when I'm looking. There's other places to do it too, but those are my big three that I would recommend looking at. The next item I want to talk about is when you're purchasing items. What's the best safe way to do it? So if you're having any issues, you can go back and dispute if you got something that was wrong or not what you're expecting when you're buying something retro. So I highly recommend using PayPal. Anytime and every time you're buying something online, retro or anything over online, I would use PayPal to make sure that you're able to dispute if you get something wrong. And here's an example. I ordered me an emulator that's supposed to have like 500,000 games, maybe 50,000 games, maybe I'm a little high, but it was supposed to be really, really cool. I thought it would be great. I paid like $40 for it. It's something I saw on Facebook, and I waited a month for it. It came from China, was really excited to try it out, and when I opened the package, this is what I got. I haven't even opened it. 620 games, kind of looks like the old Nintendo, but just completely not what I wanted or what I expected. So what did I do? I disputed it on PayPal to make sure to, you know, that this was not what I ordered. This is a whole bait and switch. This is bad. And that I just wanted a refund. So it took about a week. They look into it. I told them exactly what happened. I sold them a picture of this. I showed them what I was going supposed to be getting. And I got my refund. They rewarded me the refund, got the money back. So if you ever have a seller tell you he doesn't use PayPal, he doesn't want to use PayPal, he had been burned in the past or whatever the case might be, don't buy from him. Turn and run. It is not worth it, because this protection that you got where you can dispute it is just very helpful, and I would recommend it for anyone who's buying anything retro or anything online. So that's my two cents. So use PayPal. Another recommendation I make getting into retro computing and getting back into the Commodore 64 is to join the Facebook Commodore 64 groups. They're great. A lot of great people out there with a lot of great advice. You can learn so much. And one of my favorite groups is the Commodore 64/128 group. I think it's one of the largest groups, and there's just a lot of good people on there. So when you have questions, when you're having problems, if you're not sure about different things, that is a great resource to work with and go to. I use it all the time. So if you're not a part of the groups for the Commodore 64 on Facebook, I recommend highly joining those. So we've got our power supply, we purchased our Commodore 64, drug it out of the attic, and now we're trying to figure out how to hook it up to a monitor, a TV. The old adapters just don't work anymore. Well, I have a video out there that I use on this affordable adapter that I can now connect to the VGA monitors, and this one right here is connected using this converter. It's relatively cheap. This one's under $20. I have been told that a lot of people that use the PAL systems have issues with these, but over here in Texas, NTSC, I have zero issues with it, no problems with the latency. But again, this is just an affordable option. I have quite a few systems, so I want to be able to hook them up quick. I get all my monitors from Goodwill. When I go there and look at Goodwill, I can get, you know, $6 to $13. And I like the square monitors. I like to look like the old screen and not the long monitors. So I want it to look hook up to VGA. This converter also has an S cable where you can hook directly up to the, if you have a TV that has the S cable. So this is one option. this is what I use, and I'm trying to just stick to what I've used it to recommend. There are other more expensive options out there, and if that's what you want, by all means, bust out and get those. There's converters to go to HDMI. I think one of them is called RetroTINK. I don't own that, but you know, there's different ones out there to look at too. But this is the one that I'm using that I know works. And so if you want to see the video, I've got that out there in my videos on this channel, so you can check that out in detail. So a nice tool that everyone recommended to me that came in very handy when I first tried to figure out how to move all my floppies over to D64, G64 files was the Zoom floppy. And this Zoom floppy is very, very handy. There's actually a YouTube site, Hey Bert, that has a really good video on setting this up. I will put the link out there for it, but I highly recommend checking that out. And that's what I use to be able to set up my Zoom floppy. Now, having a 1571 was very useful with a Zoom floppy. You don't have to have it. You can use the 1541 with the Zoom floppy, but a 1571 helps you when you want to use nib tools. And with the nib tools, what that does is when you have original floppies that have copy protection, you could actually create G64 files. So you can carry over that using the nib tools. And again, Hey Bert's the best place to go to get the information to be able to set this up. So Zoom floppy, highly recommend. Great to move all your old floppies over to the modern world and put them on your PC, have the D64 files. Now, once you got the D64 files, there's lots of things you can do with it. And there are emulators out there for the Commodore 64. And my favorite emulator is VICE. VICE is very, very easy to use. It emulates the Commodore 64 very well. It's a great way to test your D64 and G64 files out once you create them with your Zoom floppy. And so I would highly recommend downloading VICE on your PC and having that. It's a great tool to use. And if you want it and don't have a Commodore 64 or Commodore 128 any longer, it is a great, great emulator that I would highly recommend. And that's what I use. So what about games? What if you don't have floppies like I do from the 80s with all these games on there? Where do you get games online, you ask? Well, there's actually already a really good video out there by 8-Bit Show and Tell. I believe it's his second channel that he has, where you can find the Commodore 64 games to be able to download. He has a really good tutorial, so that's where I would go. That's what I would check out to if you're looking for games for your Commodore 64. So what about add-ons? What can you do if you don't have a 1541 and you want to play on your Commodore 64, but you don't have a disk drive or the floppies like you used to? You just got D64 files. Well, there's many options out there to do. My favorite, all of them, is the Ultimate 2 Plus. You can put your D64, G64, all your files in here. This is a really cool, great tool. You can see my other video on this too. But it is something that emulates a 1541. So you could put your games out there and it runs just like the drive, makes the sounds, does everything. Now, I also got the SD2 IEC. That's another option, the card that you connect in that emulates a drive to be able to load up games just like the Ultimate 2 does, or just like your 1541 or 1571 does. So this is another option, but this one, of course, is my favorite and the best of all of them. But this one is a more affordable one, and if you're looking just to keep the price down, this is another option. So once you get into retro gaming, one of the things you're going to have to learn, if you want to, is how to fix and work on these retro machines when they break, where to get chips, how to get different things repaired. So if you take your Commodore 64 or 128 out of the attic and it's not working, what are your options? Well, I actually, there's a really, again, I'm going to make a recommendation. There's a gentleman named Bill Pelton who is excellent at repairing Commodore 64s. He's in all those Commodore 64 groups I mentioned on Facebook to check out. And he is an excellent source. He can either, he will help you if you have questions. He makes test harnesses so you can actually hook it up so you can do a dead test on your Commodore 64 to get it working again. You can send it to him. A lot of times he has chips for sale. He's just an all-around great guru of repairing your Commodore 64. So if you got it out of the attic and it's no longer working, or you purchased something off of eBay and it didn't work and you're not quite sure how to do it yourself, there are options. There are great people out there. Bill's just one of them, but he's my favorite. So I would highly recommend reaching out to him if you're having any issues or needing any repairs on your Commodore 64 or 128. Bill actually has this test harness pieces here. There's actually no harness. It's all plugs directly in along with the dead test. And I got this when I was working on my Commodore 64, and you could see those videos of me repairing my first Commodore 64. But it's just a great tool to help you diagnose what's going on with your Commodore 64 if you're having any issues, and if you're into, you know, repairing and trying to save it. A lot of times you can get a better deals when they're not working. So that's it for today's video, guys. I went through and I answered all 10 questions. Please subscribe if you haven't subscribed to my channel yet. I hope this was useful for you. I hope that you got all the information. If you got any questions or anything else that you're wondering about, please feel free to put it in the comments and I'll be happy to respond. And again, thank you for joining me on another Floppy Deep Dive.